Bom dia, bom dia.
Bom
Good
dia.
Morning, everybody. We are here for another episode of our podcast. We have a couple of questions to answer that came from our students in the class. We fortunately been very busy in the classes, right? With a lot of trials and a lot of new students. And eventually, when the student gets a little bit more confident in the class, he brings up questions of all kinds, people with different backgrounds, especially people that never had any contact with jiu-jitsu before.
Yeah.
You know, they heard of it, they come to the gym, they want to find out, and then they bring all kinds of questions. That's for anybody that's more experienced, these questions may sound a little weird, you know, because they already know the subjects.
Yeah,
most but of like them. Most of the new students, they have those kind of questions.
Maybe sometimes they think about it before, so So some things sometimes here we have a couple of questions at the end, but there's two of them that are reading an article that I want to get clear, because some of the students had a question like this, but this type of comments I have heard before. And to give people context outside that they don't know about jiu-jitsu, this is good to know, right? So for example, and Jackson can attest to this, he says in the article, like, Brazilian jiu-jitsu turns you into a better person. And when that means that they have a little image that says like, oh, jiu-jitsu is a bad person filter. It has that image in the top, right? And we have one of our students that shares that if the other person does jiu-jitsu, he makes them already a better person. What do you think about that? I have my opinions on it, and then what do you think?
I agree with that in some aspects. I think jiu-jitsu not gonna make you better than anybody else, but gonna make you better than what you used to be.
Yeah.
You know, gonna make you a better person in discipline, about everything you do. And I had a conversation with a friend of one of my students this week. He called me on the side, and we are talking about a very interesting subject. You know, his friend kind of disrespected his daughter. You know, he have a young daughter, and the young daughter reports to him that his friend cursed at her. You know, and they are good friends, like neighbors, you know, and the guy was just upset and he cursed with the daughter. And he actually called her like a kind of a bad name. Then the daughter come home and say like, oh, dad, he called me this. And of course, if you have a daughter, you know how much, how aggressive that is. You know, like somebody that you trust, address something as
your own daughter like
as
that.
That's your daughter, you know? So he told me like, oh, I had this situation, jiu-jitsu helped me so much. And I was immediately expecting him to, knowing him, expecting him to tell me like, oh man, I went there and I smashed this guy and I armbar him and he never gonna mess with my daughter anymore. So what he did, he found out that this guy was in the grocery store and he went there and he was wearing his gi.
He was ready.
Yeah, he was like, everything connect in a way that he was going to jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
And he found out that the guy's in the grocery store and he said, I'm gonna pass by to talk with him. And he walked in the grocery store in his gi and he found the guy. And he comes to the guy and say, hey, can you please tell me what you told my daughter? And he say, oh, I told this, but it was not what she's telling you.
Yeah.
And then they got in an argument in the grocery store and he just told the guy what he think. Hey, can you please don't call my daughter? We are friends for a long time. My daughter is very hurt.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you really called it. I trust my daughter. If you did or not, please never do that anymore because this was really bad. And he walked away and he told to me that he had a lot of self-control in that moment, you know, like to walk to the store, you know, he walked with that
gi ready,
on his gi and everything. And he said like,
tensions
Jackson,
up.
Jackson, if this was a year ago, I would have no doubt that I would walk in the store and I'm going to get in a fist fight with him because it's unacceptable. You know, whatever he said, that exactly thing or not, he said something that hurt my daughter and I trusted him.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, to leave my daughter around him. And I think that was very nice. And I really believe on that. I see that personally, how much anger management you build training jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
You know, and this is probably the biggest part of this martial arts, like the ability you're gonna have to look at somebody that you just wanna kill that person, but you're gonna have the ability to talk and try to solve the situation because you know how powerful you can be if you take him on the ground and control him there.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that was a great example, you know, and I applied that to myself a lot. I used to have these anger issues, you know, talk with people and be arrogant sometimes, and, you know, and it just doesn't go nowhere. You know, jiu-jitsu really put you in a spot that's teach you exactly that lesson.
No, and I bet you met a bunch of professors already, black belts, that think like they're just better than everybody else just because they're black belt in jiu-jitsu.
Yeah. And this was something very common back ago in Brazil. I heard many stories of like high profile jiu-jitsu teachers go to nightclubs with 25 of his black belts and get there and like just say like, hey, open the door, otherwise it's gonna be a mess here. Yeah. And you know, and they have to facilitate them to come in. And I had to do that when I was in Brazil with my friends, you know. Mm. Like, hey guys, come in, but please don't fight during the night. You know,
control.
You know, but this used to be something like very common, you know, to overpower people because now you have this extra power.
So you were the bouncer there, and then you met somebody like a bunch of black girls, say like, hey.
I was pretty much the manager of a nightclub and I have 20 jiu-jitsu friends that come to that nightclub every weekend, you know, and like, let's say like 20% of these 20 guys, they're troublemakers, like aggravated troublemakers, you know. So I always have to deal with my job and balance those two three friends who was always drinking too much and thinking that they're good. And I remember like coming back to the gym on Monday and my professor like, hey, you come here. Wow, what do you guys think you're guys doing? Go to the nightclub, especially in Jackson's nightclub. You go there and make all this confusion there.
Mess,
and this was like common, you know, like very, very common. And today you don't see that as much.
Yeah,
you know,
it was in the beginning when jiu-jitsu was just
was like
power.
Very new, you know, and nobody knew jiu-jitsu at all.
Yeah.
And like, you were like the lion in the middle of the cats, you know. And of course you
powerful.
Drink a little bit and believe me, recently I had a situation that I lost my temper a little bit, and after I had to reevaluate my action at that moment, you know, like somebody like put me in a position, I got very angry and I ended up yelling at this person, and after I said like, oh man, what did I do, you know. And that's have not happened often, but recently I had one case that I got a little bit off control, and after make me think a lot like, man, did I do that because of everything what I know and I'm capable of?
Yeah.
You know, with that person there, maybe he didn't show me that same power and I kind of overpowered him a little bit.
Mm.
You know, didn't cause any fight or anything.
Yeah.
But I could have
handled
that.
You felt, yeah. Yeah. No, and one of the things to end up the first question is, what basically the article says, if it's a bad person filter, right? And in jiu-jitsu, in a way, a little bit it is. It makes you a little bit better if you use it the right way. It's like everything else is a tool. You can use a fork for many things.
Yeah.
You can use it for wrong things. You can use it for right things.
Yeah.
So it's like everything else. It's just a tool that you use, and you can do it for the best for you, to make yourself a little bit more patient, make yourself emotional management socially and yourself maybe. So it just makes you it just exposes you in a way. And I like, there's a guy that I listen to a lot that is called Gary Vee, that he says that money doesn't make you a bad person, it just exposes you more.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing like fame, like there's just famous people that they're just not a bad person, but just, they're too greedy. They feel the power, and but they've always been like that. They've always been.
But now they have that extra
power. Yeah, but now they have that power, so they show the values that they had.
Yeah.
So, tools like that you feel more powerful, they're gonna expose who you really are.
Mm-hmm.
And then sometimes you're gonna get caught and then reevaluate your values and say like, okay, I'm not liking this image that I have, or maybe my environment, my good friends are telling me like, hey, stop and everything. So it just exposes you more.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think, what I have learned, that when you earn power and you get into that position, you start being the bully, is because it exposes you. And sometimes either like Jackson did, he reevaluated and sat back down and said like, I'm not liking this. I'm not liking the results I'm having, so I'm going to go the other way. And the same thing for everybody that has a little bit of power, maybe at work or maybe in your own jiu-jitsu school or your own little team maybe that you have as your hobby. You think you have too much power and you get exposed.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my thought on it. And then The second one here, there's a comment that says, and we have several comments as well, several questions about in class, if it works, jiu-jitsu works as a self-defense method. If it's a good street, if it give you all the abilities to defend yourself in the street, basically. Mm-hmm. And this is what we specialize, basically, what we teach in the school. So
I don't think give you all the ability, but I think give you the best option.
One of the best options.
Mm-hmm. To defeat somebody bigger and heavier with the option to hurt that person or not.
Yeah.
You know, none of the other martial arts gonna give you that option, you know, like to control somebody and
in that manner, right?
Yes. And then let's put this example. We've been teaching autistic kids, okay? And this class is going amazing, really, really nice. Kids with spectrum and families get involved together. Yeah. And I noticed that most of the parents, they start to join jiu-jitsu because they start to participate in the class and they find out what jiu-jitsu was in a deeply understanding. And they start to see like, oh, I need to join this. I need to know this. Why? Because those kids, they're gonna grow, right? And kids with this kind of special need, they can get very violent for things that's maybe doesn't control. Make too much sense for us. And then you have a dad that weighs 160 pounds and a kid now with 18 years old that weighs 200 pounds, bigger than the dad. Okay, and this kid is out of control. And then the dad see the situation where his kid is very violent and very aggressive and he needs to control his kid and there is no help. So how do you do that? What do you use to control your son? Like your opponent is your son now.
Yeah.
So what can be better than jiu-jitsu? Nothing can be better than jiu-jitsu. And that's apply for law enforcement, nurses, doctors, whatever person that's in a place where somebody can be out of control at any time. Okay, that would be like the best option you have to control, for example, a nurse control a patient that's run out of the pain drug and he's out of control and he wants that drug now. And we had a recently video that we saw.
Yeah, the Henry share.
They did a breakdown. They trying to find this nurse to bring them to the gym to train them and teach them exactly what we're talking about here and answering the question, why jiu-jitsu would be the best option as a self-defense? It's because give you the option to control without hurt. You know, like even like the worst bad guy, the worst meaning person that's, you know, that person still maybe need a chance for something, you know, and jiu-jitsu can give you that chance. Mm. You know, to control somebody drunk, like I did many times, control somebody on drugs. Man, it's just the best tool. You control and that person gonna freak out. He cannot get out of you.
Yeah.
And gonna get tired and then the explosion gonna cool down a little bit and everything gonna be better in place, you know. And that may take a couple of minutes of, you know, but we see so much of that out there with police enforcement and unprepared
people. It's a lot of videos.
Without the necessary tools to control somebody, shooting, tasing, even the cop tasing his friend the other day, his partner, you know, tried to tase the guy, ended up tasing
him. Oh yeah, that video is crazy.
You know, so all kinds of things gonna happen. So no doubt, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is the most efficient self-defense if you need to control somebody bigger than you. And then we talked about this before, four guys, four knives in the dark alley.
Well, we're gonna talk about it next.
That's what we're gonna talk next. Yeah. Okay, so let's go there.
Yeah.
You have any comment? You have any comment about
in
this topic?
One to end it up to talk about that comment is super funny. We have a student that always brings some those situations, and then in the self defense situation, we're talking about one person that is trying to hurt you and everything. That's why we're gonna transition beautiful to this one. That is just in a one on one situation. Jiu-jitsu is one of the best. I mean, if you have someone that is way bigger than you, and then. Yeah, I always tell this to the kids in the summer camp. I mean, who's gonna hurt you more, a kid? Who's gonna be a bully, a kid that is smaller or bigger than you? Most of the time, it's gonna be the bigger one. What happens if you punch them and kick them, like most martial arts teach you? And then you kick them and they punch you, they say they punch you back. And then if they punch you back, who's gonna hurt more, you or us basically, because we're the smaller ones, or them that are bigger than us. Mm-hmm. Them,
yeah.
They're gonna hurt us more if we try to punch them and kick them. Mm-hmm. But if we try to control them with jiu-jitsu, with the techniques, and try to exhaust them, like you say, we're gonna lower down that energy, mm-hmm. so that way they can have no problem.
And there is situations also that sometimes it's two people to control one person.
Yeah.
And it's still struggle.
It's still struggle, yeah.
Three people, four people sometimes to control one single individual. And that's still a struggle. Yeah. Still a struggle, you know, like even like two guys with jiu-jitsu tools and everything mm-hmm. can face a situation where it's too hard to control somebody, you know. Mm-hmm. That's why sometimes we even train like two person against one to control that person.
Yeah.
You know, and deal with the situation better.
And you can see this in several cops video. There's two cops controlling one person, trying to arrest them, even three sometimes. And they don't even try, they don't even can control that person because they don't have the tools and they don't understand how the body works, and they can angle them properly, or do you use the right technique to just pin them to the ground? They mm-hmm. can't. They don't have the proper tools. So, and they have weapons, they have a lot of things to control that person. Still, they don't know how to control mm-hmm. them. So jiu-jitsu gives you a lot of those tools to know how to control them. Just you versus them, so that way you can control them. Well, we versus them, because we know a little bit of jiu-jitsu. So we versus them, when they try to control someone that is way bigger than us, to try to have that pin to the ground mm-hmm. and then they call for help and everything. And then
a funny story is, I went to the doctor one time with my daughter, and she had to do a suction on the ear because she had like an inflammation in the ear, and I knew she's not gonna let me do that. No, none of the kids
no
let
chance.
The ear hurt,
no
and
chance.
That noise is like just freak them out. And I was there in the office, and the doctor said, "We're gonna have to hold her, and we're gonna have to do it." I said, "Yeah, no problem, I can hold her." He said, "Okay, let me go and ask some more people to come and help." Because they usually get like 3 to 4 people to hold a
to
toddler.
Hold a kid,
a
man.
Toddler. Jeez. At 3 years old. 3 or 4 people. Okay?
They go crazy. Yeah.
Because you really need to hold that kid still, because you go with this sharp thing in the ear and cannot have any movement. Yeah. So I told him like, "Hey, I can hold her." And he like, "No, you cannot." I said, I can hold her. Let's try. And I got her and I connect everything together to my head and everything, and I hold it and say like, "Go." And the doctor like, "Can you hold the hair like that all the time?" I say, "Yeah, just go." And he gone and he did the job, and my daughter was like super connected to me, like I had like side control, mount, back, all together in one movement, controlling hair, like, and she was like crying, screaming, the guy.
Oh yeah, that stuff is horrible.
Clean the ear, like, and she could not move. Like, there's one nurse like was holding the head, but I was holding her whole body.
Yeah.
Like they usually have like two, three people to do that. And the doctor like, "Wow, man, how did you do that?" And my daughter, she's strong. She's a bigger toddler. She's a strong kid. And I hold her, and then the doctor like, "Man, how did you do that?" And I say, I teach Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And he said, "Oh man, I heard about this Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, but I never know that
you have this ability
to control a person like that." And we talk like a 3 years old. Yeah. It's hard to control a 3 years old.
Imagine three people,
and you know, and that's exactly the example that you can have. You know, I walk out of the doctor like everybody, like, "Oh man!" I walk out like, "Man, yes, that's how we do it."
No, and that's
it was really
horrible.
Cool. It was a good feeling too. Yeah. It was a good feeling.
No, and that thing, that process for like cleaning your ear is horrible. Like, it's really hard to stay still, even though you're an adult.
Noise
like
goes in your ear, and
yeah,
your ear
it's horrible.
Irritating.
So I can imagine poor Ingie going through that process. It's
hard for me to hold the hair, and you have the feeling.
Yeah,
like
that's what I mean. Like,
your
just
her screaming, you know, and trying to get out in that
hard,
panicking situation there, and you have to hold her tight and do the job.
No, and I know she
imagine,
has.
Imagine when she's 18 and I have to do that.
Yeah.
Porra, then it's
well,
like
hopefully
how
she
much
stays
harder.
Still.
Yeah, like, but imagine like she's a special kid and
yeah,
she
yeah.
get out of control for something with seizure or whatever, you know, like so many cases that can happen.
Yeah, no, like,
you know, so
it just gives you all the tools.
Yes.
Yeah, some special things like that, it can happen. Then, like in Jackson's situation, Indy has a problem with her ear, so it's gonna be the better for her if she stays there, so that pain that she has in her ear right in that moment is gonna pass in a few seconds when that process
mm-hmm.
is done. And then in the last one, to transition to that one, we have always a student that always talks about, but what happens if you have two guys, three guys with this, with that, and there's a situation here that I just read that I was like, okay, we need to talk about it, so that way they listen to this. And people like him that they're just trying to see, to cover all their bases, right? So let's just put this situation. So if you get in a fight in an alley with like four guys jumping you with a knife, the guy says here that jiu-jitsu won't work. Ask yourself this, what martial art is gonna work?
Yeah.
What martial art is gonna work? Four knives. Be real, be real, be real with you.
Four people, four knives.
Don't watch any movies. Be real with you, yeah, a little bit.
No, like four people, just four. Don't exist. It's impossible. You know, for you to be effective against two opponents with a knife.
Mm.
You know, maybe one you can slip out, but two opponents with a knife, you already.
This better, we're talking about four.
You better know how to run and find a way out of it, because you're not going to be able to fight somebody with two knives. Or, you know, there is ways, like there is very few situations that you might be able to, you know, like, but maybe one guy come with a knife, the other one trip and fall on the ground on top of his knife, and he die, and the other two
crazy
run away.
Lucky,
it's, like, it's impossible.
No, but like if you be real, like the percentage of you escaping without a scratch is super low. The percentage of you getting at least cut here and there, and if you get cut badly, that's super high percentage. Mm-hmm. Four guys or two people with knives is high percentage of you getting hurt. You getting, and just a cut with a knife is bad.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have any experience on it, but I don't want any experience on it either.
Yeah. And then you talk about that, like four guys with four knives in a back alley, like
where, come on,
where,
like,
what did you do to be that in that situation?
Exactly,
you know, like,
exactly.
You know, sometimes I understand that can happen in a very coward
way. If you're super
way,
bad luck, yeah,
you know,
bad.
Like, there's a lot of cowards there that they would like really make the situation happen.
Yeah.
You know, but this is rarely going to happen. There is a very famous story about jiu-jitsu of the U.S. Marine who controlled a terrorist inside the train with AK-47. You remember this story?
Oh, yeah.
The guy was like, the AK-47 jammed in the train, and he had the time to jump on him and control him on the ground.
Oh, he used jiu-jitsu now?
Yeah, he used jiu-jitsu.
Oh, didn't know.
No, this was a very famous story.
No, I know. It's a movie about the three friends.
Movie.
Yeah,
there's a movie
three
about
friends.
This guy now.
Oh, man, I forgot what it's called.
And that's exactly the situation. Yeah,
in
Europe,
Spain, I think, right?
Yeah, Italy, Spain, somewhere in a train.
Yeah, if you know what we're talking about, just look it up.
Yeah,
I think,
we can
I know
put
what
a link of that video. Very nice. I watched that video so many times because this Marine was really like saying like, no, that was not me. It was just, I had this martial art with me that gave me the confidence. So when I look at the situation, the guy with the AK-47 jammed and I knew what to do. And I went there and I took him down and I took the gun away from him. You know, and we talk about a Marine, a guy that's experienced with...
No, but at the same time, it's not two guys with AK-47, it's one person
jammed the AK-47.
There's opportunity there for you to do that, and then he was trained in being super calm and cold to do that. But we're talking about, like, there's a situation that I was talking to a student telling him that it's so rare here in the U.S., and we know this. Jackson, again, comes from Brazil. I come from Venezuela. And the situation in our country happens all the time. In my country, they kill you just for fun because they're so hungry there. They don't have no food. Mm-hmm. Right now, they're fighting for even light. Depending on where you are in Venezuela, you're passing a bad time right now. If you don't have much capital there, it's really bad. And they don't care if they kill you or not.
Yeah.
They just get your stuff and they kill you. Mm-hmm. Then they don't care just because they're so hungry.
Survival.
So yeah, it's your survival mode. So if you there in that situation in the U.S. is rarely gonna happen.
Mm-hmm.
In those type of countries, probably it's higher chance. But here in the U.S. is rare, super rare. Like the only chance that it will happen if they target you. That's super bad luck if the target you did something already before. If you didn't do anything, you still got targeted. Like it's really, really bad luck, like I said. But it's super rare that you get like four people or one with a knife. It's rare that you get robbed like that. If you get robbed, sometimes it may happen. You just give your stuff and they go. They don't care. They just want your stuff and then go. But it's really a situation that you don't get put. Like... But what happens, I think one of the situations that he told me, but what happened if they got you with a knife already, like on your neck or something like that? You give your stuff and that's it. Give your stuff and then they're going to go. Like the only thing, their goal is just to get the easy target get the stuff, get the money, get out. In the US, I think it's like that. You're not as hungry as in other countries. I don't know the whole thing. I don't know the country of everybody.
Yeah, the survival level definitely
is totally here is different. Less. Yes. I think, I believe it's less. And then if totally you see, different. Yeah, if you see the percentage of robberies here or people that get killed by getting robbed, it's low, it's rare. And like if you can talk to somebody as your friends, depending where you live, of course, you're going to get more robbed depending where you live. But in most communities, it doesn't happen.
Yeah, it's another story that happened too. Like when I opened the gym, a guy came in and we are training guard, like how to defend guard and stage 1, 2, 3, this kind of situation there. And the guy come and asked me like, hey, but what about if I hit on the groin? And I was showing him the technique and he like put the hand like, what about if I hit you here? And I say, and I told him like, well, first I'm gonna be very angry. If you hit me there, you have like to really knock me out, because otherwise I'm gonna be super angry. And then passed, and that's the answer that I used to give all the time. Like, hey, if what about if I hit the groin, you know, like from the top here, and I go and I hit right in the groin. And I always say like, hey, it's really hard to have one efficient punch there that's gonna really neutralize me. You know, you're probably gonna just aggravate the situation, hit me there. And then after I read a study of a guy, he watched 200 or 300 YouTube fight videos. And he made a data analysis of how many of those fights had groin hits, groin attack.
Yeah.
And the number was zero. You know, like, so pretty much rarely happened somebody in a fight try to hit the groin efficiently.
Yeah.
You know, this just don't go in people's head. You know, like it's so chaotic. You know, like a fight without strategy that's you don't think about. Unless just, you have trained that before. Yeah. Maybe you are like a Krav Maga practitioner for years and you know like you're very you're
thinking ahead, the groin
and you know the guard here would could not be so efficient against somebody that have that kind of accuracy of hitting the groin there and neutralized you.
Yeah, yeah.
But like how many people do have that kind of skill, you know? So it's something that rarely happen, you know? So it's, students ask all kinds of questions. I always ask them like, which level of a situation are you? You know, like they ask me like, ah, but what about if this is like, who are you fighting? Who you fighting? Tell me more about the situation you created.
The bad guy.
The guy is like 300 pounds, power lifter, Krav Maga instructor for 20 years, and military background. You know, man, you in trouble like bad, you know? Like I don't think like jiu-jitsu or anything else gonna happen when you have that kind of a well-trained opponent that's have a lot of background on him and now you have a fight with this guy. No, you can't, you just cannot. Okay, you cannot fight a guy like that. So it's, you know, the benefits of jiu-jitsu gonna always be for the regular person, you know, the regular guy. We not talk about athletes, we not talk about an arena or a professional fight environment that you're gonna go there and train. You talk like a street fight, a traffic argument,
yeah,
a grocery store,
regular stuff, yeah,
you know, like car wreck or something, you know, or somebody that said something better to your daughter and you have to go there and talk with that person not knowing what to expect, right? And it's especially here, you know, in the US, I have a friend, his name is Braulio Estima. Very, very, very well-known competitor, world champion, and he told me a story that happened with him in the U.S., and that was very, very interesting story, and he is very lucky to be alive. He was in the grocery store, and exactly what I'm saying here happened. He was driving his car, somebody come and blocking him, they start an argument, and he came out of the car to talk with this guy, and the guy came out of the car and pulled a gun to him, you know, and this guy is a world athlete. You know, put the gun to him, and even though that's not his specialty, to work like gun defense and this kind of self-defense, he's more like a competitor. He put the guys down, and I don't remember exactly if he put the guys to sleep or not, but he ran away, and the guys actually shoot him 3 times. Okay, the guy got his gun back and shoot him 3 times in the parking lot.
Damn.
Okay, and then now the question is, was that worth him come out of his car and have argument with this guy, even though that he's have all this power on him?
Yeah.
He took the guy down, he did the right thing, and he thought was done, and the guy stood up and got the gun. I don't know if the guy showed the gun before, was after.
Yeah.
I think he controlled the guy on the floor, and the guy went
the
in
gun.
The car, pulled
yeah.
the gun, and shoot him 3 times while he was running.
Yeah.
You know, so who knows? He didn't know. He looked to the guy, and he didn't evaluate, like, oh, this guy have a gun for sure. You can't say that. You know, like, can be anybody can have a gun. Anybody can have a weapon. You know, so the fact that he left his car to have an argument and had that little altercation with the guy, with the guys there, could have cost his life, you know. And for such a jiu-jitsu ambassador, you know, like a guy that really delivered jiu-jitsu all over the world, could have gone. Well, actually, and this actually happened recently with a Brazilian jiu-jitsu black belt, also a competitor. Same thing, fight altercation, stop the car. He came, the guy put the gun in his face, he kept going. Tried to take the guys down with the gun, and the guys killed him. You know,
it happened last year, no?
It happened last year in Brazil. So, you know, don't fool yourself and have this sense of
power,
power that's gonna lead you in an even worse situation.
Yeah, and that transfer to the first one.
Excuse me.
It doesn't make you a better person either way. If you know any martial art, doesn't make you a better person.
That's
not
the point.
It just makes you. Makes you have an insurance just in case if you have to really use it.
You know what to do.
You know what to do, but
yeah, but
the rest of it.
Yeah.
And there's one thing to end up the last one. There's something that I heard from Jocko Willink, so we can finish the podcast. That if you really want to defend from somebody else, you have a gun. If they really try to attack you, hurt your family, hurt you, you have a gun to end up the situation nice and quick. The other one is gonna be the second one is jiu-jitsu. After that, wrestling. After that, Muay Thai. After that, so. The first tier, if you really want to end up things, is weapons. So either a gun is has more range, it can help you out, and then it has a knife, and then after that, jiu-jitsu can help you a little bit more. So hand-to-hand combat, basically. And I like the not that I like the, but
so
it just gives you
level, right?
It gives you a little perspective about how realistically, if you want to really defend yourself in a way, you really have to understand how a gun works and everything. And have confident with it, so that way you don't have any mistakes. And happens on every single time that goes to the news, like a kid pick up the gun or something like that. You need to understand what you have.
Yeah, exactly.
When you buy one,
it's
so
a whole new training. You know, to have a gun, it's
you need
like
to go
you're
through
gonna train
training.
As much as you become a blue belt in jiu-jitsu.
Yeah, you need to go through training.
To train, learn how to shoot, buy, get the license. And
everything.
Have everything like to bring
to
the
keep
gun
it safe,
to
keep it from
safe,
the family.
Have
yeah.
a safe. You know, so it's a whole process too, you know, and then you're going to have a gun. You're going to be able to defend yourself with a gun that can also aggravate the situation even more. You know, if the gun is the only thing you have and the guy call you something and you want to defend yourself and have to pull a gun for that, for everything is also.
Yeah. So the idea here is that either way, if you have a gun, like we said before, it doesn't make you even better. So the idea is to use the gun at the last resort, that if you have to. The same thing as martial arts, the same thing as everything else.
Did somebody ever pull a gun to you?
No, I'm lucky to not have that.
It's
yeah.
no good.
Yes, yeah, no, not
it's
pretty
very traumatizing.
Situation.
Just the fact somebody gonna come and gonna do this for you. Hey, if you don't stop now, I'm gonna have to use it.
Yeah.
That's going to be in your life forever.
I can imagine.
Forever, okay? Just that situation there going to be traumatizing like forever, you know? Like just like the 30 seconds of the situation, you know?
Just
that somebody going to come and going to overpower you with a gun like, hey, look, if you step one more time, I kill you.
Yeah.
Okay, you're going to go away, the guy going to go away, but that's going to be in your head forever.
No, and
you know, it's very, very...
Not only that, if you're in the receiving end of it, the out of control... of you, the other person has that power of they can take your life in any case. Do you really want to feel that? You having the gun and you, the other person, being the receiving end? The receiving end, you want to avoid it at all costs, first of all. And the other part, if you have the gun and the other person just made you mad just because they call you names in the streetlight, it doesn't make any sense for both situations, for both. So, thank you guys.
Having a gun is a crazy...
It's a responsibility.
Irresponsibility, but very... very necessary in most of the cases, you know, like I want eventually have a gun in the house and to protect my family, And yeah, I'm looking forward to learn that. But yeah. I already learned
a different process.
Little bit of jiu-jitsu. Mm-hmm. So I think my next step now is eventually have a weapon and learn how to use it. You know?
Yeah. No, I guess if you have any comments like that or any questions, we're just gonna have that feedback from the students and then pick some of the topics that you guys have that's gonna bring you the most value. So if you have anything, please do. Please leave it in the comments. Anything else?
That's all. Thank you very much. Let's go run the day. Thank you, guys.
Bye-bye.
Have a good day.
Obrigado.